Okay, yeah, there was a question actually that is interesting. So it's how do you do that when many gates depend on the same parameter? Sorry. So this is actually what happens in yeah, in some interesting situation, what are called, for example, these quantum convolutional neural networks. Or so in that case, yeah, you just need to apply this shift rule to each parameter independently, to each gate independently, and then sum the results. You can just use the product rule essentially. So it's you can apply it also in that case. Just sum the results by shifting each of the gate independently. Each of the gate with the same parameter. Yeah. Okay. Do you want me to get started with the talk?
Yeah, we can start. Thanks.
Okay. Okay. Right. Okay. So thank you again for this. So today I will give you maybe an overview of some of the very recent, I would say, progress we've done in this field. So the field that I was actually introducing before, which is about using a quantum computer to do variational state preparation. As you can see, the distance between theory and research is not that big, and which is a feature, I would say, of this field, in the sense that it's still a very young field where younger generations like yourself can be very, very helpful and can also have a lot of success in devising new methods, essentially, again, because the gap it's really small between what has already been established and what is to be established. So this is just a small example on my side. I will tell you what we've been doing in my lab at EPFL, and also in collaboration with many people that I will name during my presentation. Again, here I'm concerned about the variational methods. I've already introduced those during my lecture, but another way of looking at variational methods a bit more broadly in the context of quantum state preparation is that in general, we are interested in preparing some given some target, if you want, the quantum state, for example. I was showing some example before. But in general, I mean, it turns out that if you really try to think about how many of these states exist in Dilbert space, well, there are essentially infinitely many. And if you want to specify one of those, just one of those explicitly, you need to specify all the coefficients or to prepare the state very precisely by somehow being able to target one point if you want this huge space. And this task is in general hard. So that's why, for example, there are some states that are the solution of NP-hard problems that are hard to prepare because in general they will live in a set of states that are hard to target because they are essentially very random to a large extent. However, I mean, there's a caveat. So the problem that allows us to save the day, in a sense, using insights from physics, is that we are not interested, again, in most of the cases, in preparing general states, so like random states, for example, in this Hilbert space, but we are rather interested in preparing specific states, like the one that I was discussing before, let's say the ground state or the time-dependent evolution. Or if we have some limbla, the Seebeck master equation, so these are what I would call physical states, and these occupy a corner, if you want, of all the possible physical states, which is exponentially smaller than the all possible physical states that are instead irrelevant for physical application. Okay, so then the goal of variational methods is to try to represent variationally, for example, with the parameterized quantum circuits that I was discussing before, this corner of variational states and try to span this manifold and try to have a manifold of parameterized states that is as large as possible in order to cover this subset of physical states. This is the main idea of, for example, parameterized quantum circuit, but this is much older. Again, there are classical representations, for example, of variational quantum states that are very powerful, and I will discuss them also towards at the end. And in general, we will try to see how we can use the best of these two worlds, both classical and parameterized quantum circuits, to try to attack the problem of preparing these quantum states, right? So this is what I depicted here. So in general, we expect, so this is not strictly proven, but we expect that the parameterized quantum circuits, or in general, you know, quantum computers, can prepare some states that are larger, okay, than what you can efficiently prepare with classical computers with other representations. However, I mean, this is an optimistic diagram at the moment for reasons that we have been discussed also during this school. And the reason is that in practice, for the states that we can prepare on quantum circuits, on quantum computers at this point, the actually explorable area of states that we can represent, it's actually much smaller, and it's typically contained, I would argue, in this yellow region at the moment. Okay, so the reason why this is the case is because if you have a noisy quantum circuit, the family of states that you can prepare are much smaller than the one that you can prepare with a noiseless, error-corrected and large quantum computer that would correspond to this region. So at the moment, we are still inside this yellow region, with the blue one is contained, the effectively accessible blue one is contained in the yellow. But we hope that eventually, you know, maybe we will reach a point where we will reach an actual quantum advantage in representing physically relevant quantum systems. And hopefully this will come in the next years or maybe a decade. Now, the first approach, variational approach that I would like to discuss in the context of quantum state preparation, so again, in the context of quantum computing, is what we call the quantum natural gradient. So this is a paper we did last year or so in collaboration with Xanadu, which is a startup in this space of quantum computing, when I was still at Flatiron Institute, and this was strongly driven by James Stokes, who is a postdoc there. Now, the idea, I mean, as we've seen to a large detail, with a lot of details in the previous presentation, when you have a variational quantum circuit, you want to minimize a loss, and typically in the approaches that we were discussing before, we were using the gradients, right, to minimize this loss. Okay, so we have this iterative approach where we update the parameters at the next step using a gradient of some loss function. Again, the most popular, I would say, approach that is used a lot, you know, in quantum computing, in machine learning, other applications, is the gradient descent. Okay, so in the gradient descent, as we've seen before, you update your parameters at each step, just following the gradient direction with some small learning rate. Now, it turns out that you can show that this update, it's a nice way actually of seeing this update in an alternative way, in a dual way as it's called. You can see this update actually has an optimization problem because, you know, we like transforming direct things into optimization problems, into an optimization problems where essentially you look for the best parameters that minimize this cost function. So essentially this is the update in the direction of the gradient direction, where theta is the update that I'm looking for. And then you have the interesting term is actually this one, which is a loss, it's a penalty term that is inversely proportional to eta, that will penalize, if you want, moves in this gradient direction that are too far away from my initial step that I had, my initial set of parameters that I had. So you see that the larger eta, the smaller this penalty will be. So, and again, you can see it here directly, the larger will be your steps, or the smaller eta, the larger this penalty will be. So the smaller will be the steps, okay? So this is just, again, a completely alternative way. But this tells you that the penalty that you're putting is a penalty in L2 norm, essentially. This is what is written here. So it's the square in L2 norm. However, it turns out that there is a better way of doing this update. If instead of considering the L2 norm, which is the norm of the parameters, you consider a more natural norm, which is the one that enters this game of the natural gradient. That has been introduced in this paper in the machine learning community by Amari, which is known as the natural gradient. So the idea is that, for example, if you look at loss fun, you look at your loss function if you want, Euclidean space, so the space of your parameters. So typically, what can happen is that a small variation, for example, of one of your parameters can actually lead to a large variation of your loss landscape, right? Because the loss landscape is a complicated function of your parameters, right? Otherwise, a large variation of some other parameter might lead to a small change in your loss, okay? So it's clear that this metric, if you want, is not really representative of what's going on in the loss space. So what you want to do is that instead you want to work in a metric where actually doing some change of your parameters in this other metric is correspond to a small or a large change in the space of the loss function. And it turns out that this metric that here I indicate with G, so G is my metric tensor that I will introduce before, will allow you also to define a new modified, if you want, gradient descent approach, where instead of using this L2 term in this standard gradient descent, you somehow move, so you do your gradient descent in a direction that also minimizes changes in this metric G, okay? Now, what is this metric G that we have to use? Well, in general, again, as I was mentioning, you want to measure how close, how big is the change that you are doing to your loss function, or equivalently, actually, how big is the change that you are doing to your parameterized quantum state. So an idea then is to define as a measure of closeness between two parameters, not the distance, just the L2 distance between theta 0 and theta 1, for example, but the fidelity between these two states. So you see that this is a measure of the distance between theta 0 and theta 1, an induced measure, that will lead to a metric tensor that is written here, you can show, I'm not doing the derivation in this presentation, that is given by the real part of this object, which is called the quantum geometric tensor, okay? So you can see a detailed derivation in our paper in quantum here. So this is the natural metric tensor that one should use to measure the distance between two parameters, not the L2 metric that is typically used in standard gradient descent. And this is what people use also in machine learning applications, both and also in classical variation. So what is the advantage of doing that? For example, I mean, if you rescale your parameters by some amount, let's say that I rescale this is a very simple loss function, but let's say that I rescale my parameter by 5, then what happens is that your loss function will change accordingly. But if in the first case, when your parameters are not rescaled, the gradient descent will converge maybe as well as the natural gradient. In the second case, because of this rescaling, you see that the gradient descent, will have a harder time converging. And the reason is that since you are rescaling your ansatz, your loss function, and you keep the learning rate constant, essentially it happens that you're doing much larger changes than what would actually be useful to be stable in this loss landscape. So this is just a small example, but if you do this rescaling even worse, so for example, by a factor of 20, the gradient descent will fail completely converging, whereas the gradient descent, the natural gradient descent, which is completely insensitive to this kind of rescaling, would instead converge as much as before. So this tells you that it is also a natural way, if you want, of removing dependence on the choice of the nature of the learning rate, which is sometimes something that you want to avoid. So just to give a small example, which is also discussed in this tutorial on the page of Penny Lane, which is a very nicely done webpage with a lot of tutorials in quantum computing that I encourage you to see. But you can see that for this very simple parametric quantum circuit, where we will just measure, if you want, the expectation value y on this qubit, you immediately see that the natural gradient, quantum natural gradient descent, is more efficient at finding the minimum instead of the standard gradient descent. For example, for this specific application, it was a very simple one, but one of the earliest that we did. I will show you more in the future. However, there is a problem when you try to apply this natural gradient, and that's why we try to do an improvement over the original method that we introduced last year. And this year, in collaboration with people at IBM, especially Julian Gasson, who's also one of my students at EPFL, we've devised what we call the fast quantum natural gradient, so a way that is efficiently implemented also on quantum hardware, more efficiently than the previous one. So why? So what is the issue? So the issue is that if you try to measure again this metric tensor, okay, so that I was discussing before, because maybe this was not specified here, but okay, I just sketched it here, but I didn't discuss it. But essentially, when you do this natural gradient, then you see that you have to the solution to this optimization problem is an update of your parameters where you precondition the gradient with the inverse of this metric tensor. Okay, so you have to be able to estimate this metric tensor somehow using your variational your quantum hardware in order to do this update. Okay? So it turns out that estimating this metric tensor with the quantum hardware can be done with a generalization of the shift rule that I was discussing before during the lectures. So for each pairs of parameters, you have to do four evaluations of the cost function. This is written here, a cost function, which is the overlap, but okay, the details are discussed here. However, the problem is that you have to do this for all pairs of J1 and J2, which are the parameters in your answers. So if you have a large number of parameters, so let's say that you have 1,000 parameters, and we will soon get there, I would argue, with modern hardware, then the cost of doing this is quadratic in the number of parameters. So this is by definition inefficient for machine learning standards, where instead we would like to work with an approach which is linear in the number of parameters. So for example, the gradient descent is linear in the number of parameters, whereas this one will be quadratic. So there is some hidden cost if you only do this quantum natural gradient descent. And indeed, if you factor this into account, if you take this into account, the measurement cost that comes from the fact that you have to measure these extra components that you don't have to do in the gradient descent is significant. So for example, if you compute in the simple example that I was showing you before, how many shots you have to perform on the actual hardware. So this is actually something that I encourage you to do when you try to evaluate your quantum algorithm. Always try to see how many function evaluations, how many shots I have to do. So you will see that, for example, for the previous example, the advantage is almost lost, essentially, because it's true that you converge much quicker in the optimization steps, but you will need essentially as many runs of your quantum circuit to get there. So it's not very interesting for this very simple example. This is not generally true, but for this very simple example. Now, how can we improve this situation? Well, the idea is to use something that is very much used in the context of VQE in quantum computing, which is this SPSA approximation, which was used and introduced in the context of quantum computing by IBM in their first applications of VQE. So the idea is that you can approximate your gradient using two function evaluations. Let's say that I have a function f, a high dimensional function, by drawing a random Bernoulli plus or minus one variable and shifting all the parameters, not only one, by an amount proportional to epsilon with this random parameter. Okay, so this is an estimator of the gradient, which is known as SPSA, that will converge on average, so on average on these deltas, if you want, to the exact estimator of the gradient, to the exact gradient if epsilon is small enough. And you can see indeed that this is a convergent and stochastic estimator of the gradient, and unbiased, and that for example, this is the full gradient descent. This is SPSA, and you can see that on average, this is only one realization, but on average, it will follow the same direction that you will have with the standard gradient descent. And that the convergence is guaranteed under some reasonable technical conditions on the function. Now, it turns out that there's an extension of this approach also to higher order derivatives. So I'm not going too much into the details, but the idea is fairly easy. You just apply twice this SPSA to compute the Hessian, for example, right? So if you want to do the second derivative of your loss function, But okay, so it's written here, you need to form, to do four function evaluations instead of two, as before, with four random vectors instead of only two as before, only one as before. Okay. So, sorry, there are two additional random vectors and four function evaluations. Now, then there are some other tricks that can be used to estimate this improvement, to improve these estimates of the Hessian. For example, you can make the Hessian positive definite using, for example, this trick here. You can just square the estimate that you have with that you've obtained with this displacement trick. I mean, there are many other simple tricks that can be used that are used in literature. But that I will not discuss too much during this talk. But the point is that if we have this SPSA way of computing the Hessians, this can be used immediately also to compute this MEDIC tensor with only four function evaluations in total. So I can get an estimate of this GIJ just with four function evaluations using SPSA. So why? Because I can write this GIJ, so this tensor, as the second derivative, so as an Hessian, if you want, of this overlap between psi of theta prime, psi of theta squared, when I send theta prime equal to theta. So you can show, I mean, this is something that is relatively easy to show, that the essential, this MEDIC tensor is the Hessian of this overlap squared, okay? So then, again, since we can measure this overlap efficiently with the approaches that I was also discussing before, then we can just use this SPSA to obtain a much more efficient, essentially constant in the number of parameters estimate of this full tensor, MEDIC tensor. Okay? Now, and then the approach will be the same. So we estimate the loss with the standard measurement. We estimate the gradient with two additional measurements within these directions, random direction. And we estimate GIJ with four essentially additional measurements of this overlap. And then we solve this equation here to find the optimal parameters delta theta that go along this measurement. Now you see that if we do that, we actually have an advantage over, even for the simple example, over standard natural gradient descent, because you can see that this natural SPSA, this blue line, sorry, green line here, will follow closely or as close as possible the full quantum natural gradient descent, which however is much more expensive. And we will converge also much faster in terms of number of steps. Yes, unfortunately, I don't have the plot here, but I can guarantee you that we will converge much faster also in terms of evaluations if you compare it to the standard gradient descent. Now, you can compare, for example, for this specific choice of a circuit, just to show off that this approach is much more efficient. For example, if you wanted to do the standard quantum natural gradient, this would take a number of expectation bars, so the number of times you have to run your circuit that is very large. Like you need to run your circuit on Qiskit if you want for 2 million times to optimize these 100 parameters with the standard natural gradient. With our approach, with only 2,000 times, you get away and you can more efficiently, if you want, even then SPSA approximate and optimize the energy than in the other cases. So you see that there is a significant improvement over the cost of the standard quantum natural gradient descent. More importantly, for those of you who have watched the keynote by Dario Hill about the improvements, the recent improvements in chemistry that were announced, that it was also discussed about lithium hydride. So one of the ingredients that have allowed to those improvements was actually our quantum natural gradient descent, this fast SPSA in natural gradient descent. So the data that I think also he showed during his presentation was showing that they were able to optimize this lithium hydride much faster than the initial approaches. And one improvement is really this algorithm that we did in collaboration with IBM. And you can see here, for example, that in green, these are results on an actual quantum computer. You can see that in green, the natural gradient descent will the SPSA version will converge much faster than also SPSA for this real case quantum computer experiment. Okay. So I would argue that for many applications, this is the state of the art if you want to approximate or to do some VQE for your complicated, possibly complicated. Okay, this was an application again as I was mentioning, on IBQ Montreal, which is one of these computers. So I think that was a question. Should I take it now or later? I don't know. Maybe I don't know if there was a question for me, but okay, maybe I will take that at the end. Now let's go also to another topic that I wanted to discuss, where there is room again for improving a little bit over the existing methods in terms of having a possibly faster approach. So this is the context of variational dynamics, so unitary dynamics. So again, as I was mentioning also during my lecture, if you want to simulate with a quantum computer unitary dynamics, the standard approach is just to use the trotterization of your Hamiltonian. You have n steps, and then every local unitary can be implemented just with a unitary gate. Okay, so this is the standard approach. However, I mean, you see that the approximation error is arbitrary, but the CQ depth will increase polynomially with n, or if you want, with the total time that you want to simulate. So this is a problem if you don't want to use, for example, a very deep circuit, because in general, we know that the noise on the circuit will increase also exponentially with the depth of the circuit. So we would like to keep the depth of the circuit constant. So that's why we would like to do this procedure, as I was also telling during my lecture, variationally in this NISQ era. And that's what we would like to do, as I was mentioning during my presentation, the dynamics using an ansatz that contains some parameters that I can make time dependent. Okay, this was something that I already discussed before. So how do we do that? Well, the first application of this in the context of quantum computing was presented in this series of papers in the group of Simon Benjamin that were very nice, and they were based on this McLachlan variational principle that I was discussing during my lecture. And this has, however, a lot of classical counterparts that have been explored traditionally earlier than quantum computing, of course. But how does it work? I mean, traditionally, this problem of simulating the dynamics can be solved in this formulation of the time-dependent variational principle by solving this Euler-Lagrange equation of motion for the variational parameters derivatives. So essentially, at each time step in time, what you do is that you measure on your quantum computer. This is this approach by Benjamin. You measure the imaginary part of this tensor, which is the same tensor that I actually showed before, this quantum geometric tensor. There are ways to do that using some Hadamard test. I'm not going to do it in the details of this. You measure the real part of this object that can also be estimated efficiently on a quantum computer. And then you invert this MIJ to get the time derivatives of your variational parameters. Then if at each time step you know the time derivatives, you can evolve this ODE differential equation to you integrate it up to the time you want. So you try to follow the variational dynamics with your fixed depth ansatz. Okay. Now, you see that the problem is the same as before, as for the natural gradient, because here we need to evaluate for all I and j, so for all the variational parameters, this very large matrix, which is of order n squared. And also there can be noisy. So typically when you try to invert this, you can have some issues. You have to regularize these matrix. So it's best if we could avoid this costly quadratic evaluation, and also if we can avoid the inversion of these matrix in general. That's what I was saying before. It's not efficient, again, in the sense where by efficient, it's still polynomial efficient, but not linear in the number of variational parameters. Because again, here you have to estimate a number of terms here that is quadratic instead of linear in the number of terms. Now, how can we circumvent this issue? Well, it's some idea that we were developing with my student, Stefano Barison, and Filippo Vicentini, who's a postdoc also in my group. It's what we call projected variational quantum dynamics. That is, again, a quantum formulation of something that is very well known in the classical setting. So the idea is that we can transform the dynamics that I actually already hinted to this during my lecture into an explicit optimization problem, okay? So the idea is that I was also writing during my lectures is that if at time t I have my state, let's say my phi of t, then I know that the exact time evolution will be given by the exponential of minus I epsilon h applied on my state. So this is my exact state, if you want, evolved here on the right. But however, I know that I want to match this exact state with an approximate state where I change my parameters a little bit. Okay. So what I do is that now that I transform this time-dependent rational principle into an explicit optimization problem that you can see here, where I try to minimize this infidelity, so this loss function that we define in this way, in such a way that when you do the limit where an epsilon goes to zero, this quantity becomes independent of epsilon. You can do a small calculation. Okay? So you see now I have a loss function that depends on delta theta now, not on theta. And I can try to minimize it using standard gradient descent as much as I was doing before. So in a nutshell, again, then we have the same approach. Because we can measure the same structure of all variational approaches, because we can measure the gradient of the loss. Again, the loss is just an overlap. We can measure it using this computing and uncomputing approach that I was discussing during my lectures. And then again, you measure this gradient, which can be done again efficiently in order n, when L is the number of parameters. And then you get an update to your parameters delta theta that you can use when you converge to go to the next time step, okay? So this is the main idea of this approach. This is a sketch of how the dynamics works, where we are trying to depict the fact that at each time step, you try to stay close to the exact dynamics, which here is depicted with this continuous line. So we optimize locally in time these parameters delta W in a way that we match as much as possible the exact dynamics. This is a sketch of this relation. Now, it turns out that this is exactly equivalent to the standard variational principle by McLaglen that was shown before. You can just take the limit, for example, of this loss function when you send epsilon to zero. And you can show, indeed, it's very easy that if you take this limit and you find the minimum of this loss function, the optimal theta will satisfy the same equation of motion that was defined by McLaglen. The main difference again is that we don't have to form explicitly this metric tensor G, but we can just obtain the same result by minimizing something which is nominally linear in the number of variational parameters. Okay, so again, this is just a recap of what I was already saying. So, but essentially for every time step, we have to perform 2n circuits evaluation to evaluate the gradient. Some M optimization substep because you have to converge these objects. So at the end, everything will be again nominally linear in number of parameters. We have prefactor that in practice we see it's relatively small. So I can show you maybe some example where we try to simulate the dynamics of our favorite transfeedizing model with an ansatz similar to what I was discussing during my lecture notes. For example, we can show the integrated fidelity as a function of the number of samples, as a function of the number of quantum computer evaluations that you have to perform on your computer, up to some time t that here is taken to be one, I think. And you can see that, for example, if you do this PVQD, so our approach, the number of samples that you need to reach this accuracy of this integrated infidelity, which is written here, is significantly smaller than the number of samples you would need if you use the standard TDVA, that instead would require a lot more samples because you have to estimate the full geometric tensor. Okay, so again, this is a small trick, but it's typically quite useful if you want to implement this in practice on hardware. And if you have thousands of parameters, I would argue that this is essentially maybe the only thing you can do. There's a favorable scaling. Okay, I've already discussed this. So this is the quadratic scaling. Here we see that depending on the accuracy that we fix, we have this kind of scaling with the number of samples. If we want more accuracy, yeah, again, we pay some larger price, but still typically this is smaller for the reason that I was discussing before than the quadratic approach. You can also compare with Trotter because you can say, okay, why not doing Trotter in the first place? And, especially if you go to long times, it turns out that these kind of methods that are based on the variational compression can be very efficient. For example, you can see here a case where the PVQD with a fixed trotter depth, equivalent trotter depth, can outperform the same circuits that you would get with the equivalent trotter depth. So for example, n equal one would be what you would get with the, so the exact evolution in this case is this, line. So when you take the limit of essentially zero time step, but you can see that we can approach this limit quite efficiently using a depth that is smaller. So it's this one here, smaller than what even a relatively deep trotter would need to get to this time. Now, in the last 10 minutes, I will tell you something about the other part of the story, because you know I started telling you that at this point in time, maybe the yellow region of classical rational states are maybe still much more powerful, I would argue, than quantum states you can do on a quantum computer. So I want to tell you how do we stand also on the other side, if you want, of the story, so about classical rational states, because I think this is extremely important also for the development of quantum computing. So you want to know what are the classically hard to simulate states in a way that you can attack those instead with a quantum computer. However, if you know that there's a state which is easy to represent with a classical computer, there's no use in using a quantum computer to attack this family of states. Okay? So we have to know what are the limits, the boundaries between these two regions, and that's why we need to improve and also work as much as possible also on the classical representation of quantum states. Now, the main ingredient, so my favorite ansatz, if you want, that we use on the classical side, you know, on the classical side, we cannot use parameterized quantum circuits, because by definition we don't have quantum computers, but we can use, for example, neural networks. So this is what I call neural network quantum states that we introduced a few years back. So for those of you who are familiar with neural networks, this is a quite natural way of parameterizing things. For those of you who are not familiar with neural networks, let me try to explain this for a moment. So our goal here is to write an ansatz, if you want, for the wave function. Again, this is not a quantum circuit now, but it's a classical function, okay? So the wave function is just a classical function of some input vector, if you want, which are my, the basis set, this bra here, which in my, for example, sigma z basis. Then the idea is that I can parameterize this high-dimensional function with a neural network. So for example, what I do in a deep network is that I take my input vector on the right, I apply a linear transformation W, then a nonlinear transformation G, then a cascade of this linear and nonlinear transformation until I reach the last layer, the last output. Okay. Well, and then, I mean, if you play with the depth of these circuits, you can really also encode a lot of entanglement. You can simulate also very interesting quantum states. Now, what we can do, I mean, we've done a lot of applications of this in the classical setting, but the application that I think is relevant if you want to compare also more directly to quantum computing is to try to simulate quantum computing with a classical machine. Okay? So this might sound like a perversion, you know, something not really nice to do on our side, but indeed this is important because we want to understand how hard it is on the classical side to simulate a quantum computer. So how would you simulate a quantum computer on a classical machine using, for example, a variational approach based on neural networks? So this is what we introduce in this paper. So the idea is that, for example, if I have a neural network, so let's take these neural networks here. So these are RBM, it's not too important, but these are just one layer neural network, very simple. So it turns out that if you apply some gates on these neural networks, for example, these are Z gates or the control Z gates, you can, on a neural network, the output state will still be a neural network of the same size essentially, but with some of the weights modified. So if you apply, for example, this gate or these control Z gates with, you know, arbitrary far apart, if you want, qubits, you can still get out a neural network with the same size, okay, essentially. The problem arises classically. So the reason why we cannot simulate quantum computing classically exactly is because instead, if you try to apply Hadamard gate, so a superposition gate, if you want, onto a neural network state, you will not get in general out another neural network that is easily written down, not in general, there are special cases, but in general, no. So what you have to do, and this is where the game starts, so you have to try to approximate the action of a Hadamard onto a neural network with another neural network. So this is where the variational approximation enters in the classical setting. So you act with your Hadamard on your variational state, which is a neural network in this case, and you have to try to approximate this phi, the exact state, with another neural network with different parameters that apply. Okay? And again, as much as we do it in the quantum case, we were doing it already before in the classical case, minimizing the infidelity. So the loss function in this case would be the infidelity. You can show that also classically you can measure that efficiently with Monte Carlo. Now, the point and the reason why you want to do that is because, as you've seen during this conference, this school, the noise that you have on the quantum hardware is a very important factor. Okay, so if you have a hardware with noise, quantum hardware with noise, this means that if you run a given quantum circuit, okay, and you have some noise level on each qubit, it means that at the end, the final state you will be preparing is not the exact state you expect, right? And it turns out that the fidelity will decrease exponentially with the depth of the circuit if you have some finite noise level and if you are not doing error correction, of course, okay? As we are not doing in these days. However, on the classical side, it's almost exactly the same thing. The only difference is that whenever we apply a gate, only one gate, the Hadamard, we have to pay some finite fidelity. So the fact that we are not able to approximate this, to do this operation exactly, but we can apply this gate only approximately, okay? So this means that we have to pay some price when we go to the next step of the circuit. So what makes sense, which has also been done with other approaches, for example, with the MRG in this other paper, is to compare the noise level that you have on the out, so the fidelity that you get at the out of your circuit with the fidelity that you get in the classical simulation. And it turns out that you know, if you want to compete with the classical methods, even very simple neural networks, you need to have very small noise, if you want, on the quantum hardware or the order of 10 to the minus 3. So this is what this plot is showing. So if you want to have the same fidelity that we have classically for this family of quantum Fourier transforms, you will need to have, in this case, a noise level of 10 to the minus 3 on the hardware. Okay? So you see that the hardware has to be very competitive in order to achieve the same fidelity that you can get with a classical approach for some application. So this is, for example, one case that we did more recently that was, I think, appearing today in the journal, but in collaboration with my former student in New York, Columbia, Mattia Medivovic. But the idea here is, for example, is to simulate this method that was shown before, this QoE approach, right? With a classical computer, because if we can simulate that classically, maybe, you know, there's not too much interest of using the quantum computer to run this specific class of circuits. So this is this family of circuits that where again you have these entangling gates that have this form, that are these easy gates here. Then you have these single qubit rotations that are these RX gates, okay? Then what you do is that you can show that with our neural networks, we can exactly simulate these entangling gates, but we have to approximate these single qubit rotation gates. So this is our deal in the classical world. Now, if you benchmark these small circuits, it turns out that even, small circuits on 20 qubits, I'm sorry, these neural networks typically get this cost function, this QA cost function pretty accurately, even for you know, some depth that we can still we can benchmark. So this is P equal 2, I think, so depth 2 in the QA. But sorry, most importantly, we can go to, for example, 54 qubits, okay, which is something that at the moment for this circuit depth is not easily done on the quantum hardware. And we can still simulate this classically, okay? So for example, take P equal 4, so 4 layers of this QoE, where you have, 500 gates, 54 qubits, and we can compute classically the cost function, the QA cost function that you see here in blue. And in this case, essentially, we don't have yet, if you want, a quantum computer that is able to run this with the same precision. Okay? So So again, this is not to detract again on the quantum computer, because quantum computers are very important, but it's just to tell you that when you see comparisons or when you look at the power of quantum computers, or even when you look at applications of quantum computers, you have to always be mindful of what is the best classical method to approximate that specific problem. And I would argue that variational methods, classical variational methods, are among the most powerful, either based on the neural networks or tensor networks, are among the most powerful methods to approximate quantum circuits, okay? So in this sense, it's not fair to compare, for example, with brute force methods that are instead based on summing of all the paths or just storing the full wave function. You have to compare with methods that scale classically, at least polynomially, with the number of qubits, because they are intrinsically variational. Okay, this is just a comparison with MPS. I will not go into these details, but just to say that there's an advantage of using neural networks over, for example, tensor network representations in terms of entanglement. But okay, I don't want to put too much discussion on that. But I just want to again finish my presentation, saying that as you've seen, that we are now entering in an era where we have much more access to quantum computers, where we are inventing many of us new quantum variational simulation approaches. And as you can see, there is, again, as I was mentioning, a relatively small gap between research and what is already known, okay? And the advantage of doing this is big, because we can use potentially more expressive states than the classical states. We can use do arbitrary unitaries. However, we are limited by noise and shallow circuits, as I was discussing. On the other hand, on the classical side, we have typically highly entangled states. So you can show that you can represent arbitrary entangled states with neural networks, for example. However, again, we have to face some limitations. So for example, we have some intrinsic noise that is due to the variational error that, again, we will need to pay. There are some unstructured circuits that we are not able to simulate, like, you know, if you take the circuits that that Google did in their quantum advantage paper. But in general, I would argue that for circuits that are relevant for physics, here the competition is tough with classical methods. And that's why we also need to push a lot more on the quantum side in order to have better answers and also better approximation methods to compete really with the best classical approaches. Thank you, and this is also to recap the collaborators and to also thank them for their work. Thank you.
So thank you for the very nice talk. And now we have questions. So let's start from the first. So it's referred to something like slide 15. So the question is, just to get a better grasp on the more technical details, what's the setting used to benchmark the performance of QNG and FQNG against SPSA? Was this system governed by an Ising Hamiltonian? And what about the circuit, number of qubits, and number of parameters?
Okay, this is a very specific question, and I might read the paper maybe if you want all these details. But so let me give you this example here. So this is the case that I was discussing maybe when the question was already asked, I don't know. But okay, so this is the case of lithium hydride. So in this case, you have, I think, 4 qubits. Yeah, I mean, it's what you can run on the hardware. So this is, it's exactly the same circuit that you simulate with SPSA and with this quantum natural SPSA. So you can see that this converts faster. I don't remember what were the specific things that were asked, but in general, I mean, we've done our best to make this comparison as fair as possible, in the sense that we try to optimize as much as possible SPSA and of course as much as possible also natural SPSA. So that's why, I mean, for example, I was showing you that if you don't do that, if you consider only the number of steps, instead you would not be doing a fair comparison, because instead the QNG is more expensive than the standard data set. So I mean, in a nutshell, yes, we have taken into account these extra costs, if you want, and it always pays back.
Okay, thanks. Then we have another question, and the question is, are there some limitation in principle in applying neural networks to bigger systems? So we go to the end of the talk.
Yes, so, okay, so there are limitations, and it's clear that that's what we have to face. So the main limitations arise in the learnability, if you want, of this state. Okay, so you see that here I apply the Hadamard and I try to learn this state with another neural network. However, when I do this procedure, I didn't tell you how we do it classically, but we use measurements from psi data, from phi, in the computational basis and also in other bases. So the problem is that if you want to learn typically a very random circuit, okay, so take again the case of Google random circuit, then in that case the number of samples that you need to learn this phi with another neural network is very large. This can be even exponentially large. So this is one limitation. And the other limitation is that the neural network structure might not be general enough to represent that state. Even though I would argue that the generality of the structure is mostly not a problem. The main limitation is really the learning approach. Yeah.
Okay, so thank you very much.